I can get used to that every week. I want to encourage you to, some of you out there, you need to work on some specials. We're still not comfortable, you know, singing over everybody and spitting on everybody, so it's great to have some specials so we can get encouraged. One part about church that's very encouraging is having the songs, because you actually worship God when you hear the song, because it invites the Holy Spirit into fellowship with us. So that encourages us. He mentioned about them pews being full. You know, and you get to thinking, I wonder if our pews will ever be full again. Might not. I don't know. Maybe it will. But we'll have to just see how that goes. And a lot of preachers have dealt with things through the years. A lot of Christians have dealt with things through the years. But the Lord is always faithful, no matter what situation is, to get us through. And He's been good to us, so good to us. Let's open our Bibles to Mark chapter number 9. Mark chapter number 9. If you'd like to stand with us as we read Mark chapter number 9, we'll begin in verse number 14. Mark chapter 9. In verse number 14. And when he came to his disciples, he saw a great multitude about them, and scribes questioning with them. And straightway all the people, when they beheld him, were greatly amazed, and running to him, saluted him. And he asked the scribes, "What question ye with them?" And one of the multitude answered and said, "Master, I have brought unto thee my son, which hath a dumb spirit. And wheresoever he taketh him, he teareth him, and he foameth, and gnasheth with his teeth, and pineth away. And I spake to thy disciples that they should cast him out, and they could not." He answereth him, and saith, "O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him unto me." And they brought him unto him, and when he saw him, straightway the spirit tare him. Excuse me, and he fell on the ground and wallowed foaming. And he asked his father, "How long is it ago since this came unto him?" And he said, "Of a child. And oft times it hath cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But if thou canst do anything, have compassion on us and help us." Jesus said unto him, "If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth." And straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe, help thou mine unbelief." When Jesus saw the people came running together, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying unto him, "Thou dumb and deaf spirit, I charge thee, come out of him, and enter no more into him." And the spirit cried and rent him sore and came out of him, and he was as one dead, inasmuch that many said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when he was come into the house, his disciples asked him privately, "Why could not we cast him out?" And he said unto them, "This kind can come forth by nothing but by prayer and fasting." I want to draw your attention to verse 24. The man here says, "Lord, I believe, help thou mine unbelief." Let's have a word of prayer. Brother Rick Hatcher, will you pray for us and ask the Lord to bless the message? Amen. You may be seated. Now, here in the passage, obviously, if you back up to the first part of chapter 9, we have the Mount of Transfiguration experience. This is when the Lord was transfigured before the apostles here, and they saw His glory, and they experienced seeing Jesus Christ in this state. And Peter, of course, says, "Hey, we need to camp out here. Let's build some tabernacles. Let's just forget the rest of the world, and let's just have church here the rest of the time on the mountaintop." And Jesus is like, "No, you can't do this. There's clarity on the mountain, but we got to get back down in the valley." And so the next day, the Bible tells us in the book of Luke, chapter 9 in that account that it's the next day that this incident happens. And it's so much like that, isn't it? You have a mountaintop experience with the Lord. You see nobody but Jesus only. You're real close to Jesus. Things are going really good. And then the next day, your world falls apart. The next day, it just seems like everything caves in. And here they come down. And here's Peter, James, and John with Jesus. And they're all, you know, ready to charge hell with a squirt pistol. And here's the disciples there with the scribes and this big argument, this big tumult's going on. There's this demon-possessed boy, and the scribes are standing around, accusations are flying, and Jesus is like, what is going on? And the disciples down in the valley can't do anything. They have no power like the power that was seen on top of the mountain. And so we come to this situation here. We have, number one, a helpless father. He says in verse 22, it's very important, he says, if thou canst do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Notice how he identifies with his son. Parents and grandparents, can we get an amen there? Your child hurts, your grandkids hurt, they go through something that's bad and awful, it bothers you. It tears you out of the frame. He's like, Jesus, help us. We have a helpless father. He can't do anything for his son, and this has been going on a long time. Then we have the hopeless son. Verse 17, look what it says. He has a dumb spirit. Now we use that word dumb sometimes in our very, you know, crass way. We're so vulgar now in our language, you know. We call people dumb and stupid. And the word dumb actually was a term that was used for somebody that had the inability to speak. Oftentimes they would be deaf and dumb. If they were deaf and dumb, they could not hear nor could they speak. But this man has the inability, this boy rather, he can't talk. Now it's interesting when you read the new versions, not that you need to go read the new versions, but the New James Bible says in Matthew 17 account that this man is an epileptic. If that's the case, then this would make epilepsy a spiritual condition, and we know that's not true. Epilepsy is not a spiritual condition that somebody's demon-possessed like some of the Catholics taught in the Dark Ages, or some of the ignorant people would take people that had these type of mental disorders and they said, you're demon-possessed, and they throw them in a dungeon somewhere. Now we know there are actual physical, psychological disorders. Some of those are physiological. They're not spiritual in nature. So you can just take the new Bibles and throw them in the trash can where they belong. And so that just causes all kind of trouble. What you find in the King James Bible is the term lunatic. That thing is a term that's used twice, and that thing is connected to a spiritual problem. So we have a hopeless son, and then we have hapless disciples. These disciples down here on the ground, they have no power. And here's what I want you to notice in verse 19. When you compare Matthew 17 and Mark chapter 9, it's almost as if Jesus is talking to the disciples in one point, and then at one point it's almost like it says he answered him, like he's talking to the man. And I think that's very important when you compare these accounts, because what is taking place with the disciples' inability to cast out this devil is the same thing that's taking place with the man. You say, what is it? It's a lack of faith, and it's a lack of power. And so we see that connection here. And I want us to understand as we move into this thing that we are not Jews in the first century that have the apostolic sign gifts. If you break your arm, you need to go get a doctor to take the bone and put it back together. You don't need to get somebody to pray over your broke arm. Okay? If you get sick and you have blood in your urine, you need to go to the doctor. You don't come down here and let the preacher pray over your kidneys. You know, you get something stuck in your eye, go to the eye doctor. Amen. Amen. Somebody dies nearby you, you call the paramedics, and you don't ask for God to raise them from the dead. We're not in the first century. And you go fishing, you take a boat, you don't walk on the water. Amen. A snake bites you, you go to the doctor. Amen. You don't say, Mark 16 in Jesus' name. Yeah, you dance around a few times, then you're going to drop dead. So we're not in the first century, so we have to be understand that the all things, look in verse 23. Here's the verse they take out of context. They have these little songs, you know, all things are possible, all things are possible. You repeat it 500 times. All things are possible, all things are possible. If you only believe, if you only believe, if you only believe. You can believe that Dodge is going to run all day long, but if you don't take that thing to the mechanic and get it worked on, it's not going to run. Amen. These things, these all things in verse 23 are contingent on the will and purpose of God. We are in this period of the church age we oftentimes call the silence of God, because God's not speaking on top of a mountain like He did at Sinai. God expects us to live by faith in the Word of God. And that faith is oftentimes, I believe, more so tested now in this age in which we're living, because we're not able to walk across the water, not able to see somebody be raised up from the dead or see the Red Sea part. I think our faith is tested more now than it may have been in any other age. Now I want to give you some help, hopefully from this passage, we can get some help with our unbelief. You say, preacher, I'm a believer. I am too. But we all struggle at some point or other. Maybe you're walking in here, you're riding high, you're on the cloud, you have so much faith and belief in God, you just can't even fathom how anybody would have a little bit of doubt in the power of God, or a little bit of doubt in the veracity of the Scriptures, or a little bit of doubt in their Christian life. Praise the Lord, I'm glad you're that way. Pray for the rest of us. Because doubt is a very real and normal thing. And I want to preach on that a little bit this morning with the Lord's help. Notice in verse number 24, first of all, help with unbelief, the portion of his faith. Notice in verse number 24, this guy cries out to Jesus, Lord, I believe, help thou my unbelief. Here's the first thing you need to understand. A little bit of faith is better than no faith. So how much faith does it take? Well, here's the thing. You're not saved. And when we talk about salvation, we'll talk about Christian experience, but salvation, you're not saved based on how hard you believe something. You ever have somebody say, I prayed really hard. What does that mean? Does that mean you sweated? Does that mean you went without food for 24 hours? Does that mean you were on your knees? Does that mean you were on your face? What does it mean you prayed really hard? You trembled? You prayed for an hour and a half? You prayed really loud? You ever hear people in a restaurant? Lord, I want these people to hear me, to know that I'm standing for the faith. Are you preaching or praying? Now, I know sometimes you can preach while you pray. I get that. But, and I know other people are listening to you while you pray, but what do you mean by that? I prayed really hard. When the prodigal son came home, did the father forgive him because the prodigal wept a lot of tears, or did the father already forgive him before he ever came home? Are you saved based on how much you believe, or are you saved by Jesus Christ? This is where this whole repentance thing comes in theology, when you study salvation, and people think, well, bless God if you don't shed tears, and bless God if you didn't lay down the booze, and you didn't lay down the cigarettes, you didn't lay down the cussing, and you didn't lay down, let's just go ahead and talk about covetousness. You didn't lay down, you know, making sure you tithe 55%. You didn't lay down, I mean, where do you want to stop at? You want to talk about repentance? So when you bring this idea of faith up, what we do oftentimes is we pour all the responsibility on us instead of realizing we live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. A little bit of faith, better than no faith at all. Are you a believer or are you not? Amen? Okay, quit worrying about it. We make it harder than it is, and oftentimes the devil will take our doubt and he'll double it. He'll double your doubt. Are you a believer? Praise the Lord. That's great. Just like sometimes it's okay to say you love God. Well, I don't love God like a... When I sing, oh, how I love Jesus, I always say, oh, how I should have loved Jesus. I get all that false humility. But do you love God? Yes, you love God. Now, you don't love Him like you should. Neither do I. Are you a believer? Okay, we're believers. Thank God you have some faith. Doubt is normal, Christian. We are not seeing the parting of the Red Sea. We are not going to see Jesus Christ until He returns. I have never seen Him, yet I talk about Him and I preach about Him. We have a Bible, and thank God for that. And I believe, according to Acts chapter number 1, we have many infallible proofs of His resurrection. The resurrection is a historical fact. I believe that God is very reasonable. He says, come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. He gives you enough information. He gives you enough truth for you, when you believe it, to have confidence and have peace that you're following the truth. However, doubt is very normal. This isn't unbelief as a sin. We talk about people dying and going to hell. We talk about the thing that sends people to hell is unbelief, and that's true. John chapter 16, when the Holy Spirit has come, He will reprove the world of sin, of righteousness, and judgment to come. Of sin, because they believe not on Me. The reason people die and go to hell is because they don't take the cure. They die unforgiven. They don't believe in Christ. But this is not what we're talking about here. We're talking about somebody who believes, but then on the other side, they say, help my unbelief. Sometimes you go through things in your Christian life and you wonder if God cares. You know God cares, but you doubt. You go through something in your life and then it hits you and you begin questioning. That's what we're talking about here. Charles Spurgeon wrote this: as a sin, unbelief grieves the Spirit of God, but as a weakness, unbelief mourned and confessed secures the Spirit's help. That's what this guy's doing. He's confessing his belief. I want to encourage you, when you have doubts, when you have questions, when you get all foggy, say, Lord, I do not understand this. Please help me. Please clear this up. Now, we're not talking about hardened hearts. We're not talking about people saying, I'm not going to believe, and God is mean, and God is not. That's not what we're talking about. Lord will help. The Lord will help those who doubt. Remember when Peter was walking on the water and he saw the waves and he saw the stuff and he began to sink? When he sunk down in that water, the Bible says Jesus reached out and caught him. And then Jesus says, wherefore didst thou doubt? The Lord will catch you when you doubt. He's not going to condemn you when you doubt. He will catch you when you doubt. Little faith better than no faith. Here's the thing, verse number 17. Notice, Master, I've brought unto thee my son. He had faith. What's he doing bringing his son to Jesus and to the disciples? And by the way, you need to understand this. People will, as they come to God or they want to come to God, they'll go to the closest thing they know, like a church. Or like a Christian that they know, somebody's been a Christian all these years, they'll ask them questions. He's going to the disciples. He's going to those that are associated with Jesus. Build upon the faith you have instead of tearing down the faith you have. Build on that. The guy had some faith or he wouldn't be going to Christ. That's why we come to church. We build up our faith. Paul says, I commend you to God and to the word of His grace, which is able to build you up. Read the Bible, which will strengthen your faith. Listen to preaching, which will strengthen your faith. Listen to songs and hymns and spiritual songs, which will strengthen your faith. Dr. Ruttman said this: believe as much as you can and ask God to help you with what you can't believe. Amen. Now let's look at the problem with his faith. I think there are several things that really lend to this. Notice in verse number 21. First of all, I think the duration of this malady, this demon possession, that this problem that his son had. Verse number 21, he asked his father, how long is it ago since this came unto him? And he said, of a child. This has been going on a long time. Time has a way of wearing things out. You ever look at those rocks? We have some rocks on our walkway, this little egg rocks, you know. And you think about it, I pick those things up sometimes and I look at them, you know, you say, you're stupid. Yeah, maybe I am. But I look at them and I'm thinking, man, I wonder how long it took for that water, wherever we got these things, to wear those rocks out. Thousands of years, man, for those rocks. And sometimes I think about some of that stuff and you think about how time has there's a tendency of time to wear things down, and you get to thinking nothing will ever change. His son is in this condition and he's thinking, you know what? I keep trying this and trying that and I keep praying and praying and nothing happens. The perilous of analysis. He thought about it over, that's all he thinks about. Over and over and over and over, from this angle, from that angle, from this angle. He writes out this, he maps up this formula, this plan, he prays this, goes here, does this. He's just working on it and working on it and working on it and working on it, and nothing ever happens. I'm telling you, that will wear you down. And sometimes you pray about something for days, for weeks, for months, for years, and you see nothing. God doesn't give you an answer. What are you supposed to do? Ask, seek, knock. You keep asking, you keep seeking, you keep knocking. And also we have a problem here with the disciples. Not just the duration of this thing, but the disciples. Like I mentioned, oftentimes people come to us, or they come to Christians, or they come to churches. He says in Matthew 17, I brought him to thy disciples, and they cannot cure him. So you know what will happen? The lack of faith, and like I said, I believe this is tied in because he says, oh, faithless and perverse generation. He's talking to his disciples in Matthew, but he's also talking to the man. This thing's connected. This whole story is connected. The lack of faith in others will drag you down. And he sees the disciples don't have the answer. He's thinking, man, here's people that are with Jesus all the time. They're all in it. They don't understand. They can't fix it. They have problems. And that just puts another hole in his armor. You know, there's been a lot of people that have fallen out of the race because they've watched maybe their mothers or their fathers go through a crisis in their faith, and it destroyed them as a child. Or they watch somebody they respected, maybe a Sunday school teacher or somebody at church or a relative or a preacher, fall. And that has destroyed young Christians in the faith because they saw the lack of faith in others. The lack of faith in others will bring you down. I was reminded of this verse when I was studying 1 Corinthians 12, verse 26. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. Or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. In 1 Corinthians 12, he's talking about the body of Christ. You know, some of us are a pinky, some of us are an earlobe, some of you are elbows, some of you are calluses on the bottom of your feet. You know, we all have our parts that we play, right? People say, yeah, and there's some hemorrhoids in the body, right? Amen. No, everybody's a smile and a beautiful rose lips and cheeks and eyelashes and everything else. But you know, I got to thinking about that thing. When one member suffers, all the members suffer. And especially those that you're around, the circle of friends and Christians that you find yourself around, you feed off of each other. And you bounce off of each other. I'm blessed to have some good Christian preachers that I'm friends with, that I'm in the traces with. And I call them and encourage them. And they call me and they encourage me. They'll send me a message praying for your preaching this morning, praying for service this morning. I'll send them a message. I'm praying for you. And it's good to have that camaraderie. It's good to have that with our church family, where you know that we see each other week by week and we're praying for each other and we're bouncing that. And when one member suffers, the other suffers. If you're around somebody and maybe you have to work with, any of you work with Eeyores? Some of you go into work and there's Eeyore. There's he. It's either Eeyore or Sheeyore, whichever, you know. Eeyore or Sheeyore. And you know that as soon as you get around the water cooler or you go to the copy machine or whatever you have to deal when you have to deal with this person, it's going to be doom and gloom. It's going to be the sky's falling. It's going to be negative, negative. It's going to be just, you know, this is bad and this is bad and they messed up here. The boss has done this or so-and-so tattling on somebody. It's always going to just, you know what most of you probably find yourself doing? You try to avoid that person. Because you know, the longer you hang around, that stuff just kind of like a canker. It's like a cancer. It feeds. And other people's attitudes and perceptions and thoughts and ideas will get on you. And so people's unbelief will have an effect on you. The communists, and they knew this well back in the day and still know it. And they have a thing in the modern culture. We have this thing, I don't know what you call it, probably social media, but they call it propaganda. You tell the lie long enough and often enough, people will think it's the truth. And you can go back over things right now. You could go to certain people and talk about a certain news event, and you can tell them they'll have a certain belief because they believed what the news first said about it, but they didn't go back several years later when they finally, you know, it takes several years for people finally to come up and say, okay, here's what actually happened. Here's the reports. Here's the footage you didn't see on TV. Here's the such and such. But nobody knows about that because what they do is they feed off what they get. And if you're not careful, you will just feed off of what you get. And if you're around the Eeyores and you're around the doubters and you're around people that do the propaganda, and that's what they did with the communists, what they do is they get somebody and they just keep saying it over and over, God is not real. God is not real. There is no God. There is no God. If you piped into your ear 24/7, there is no God. There is no heaven. The Bible's not true. Jesus Christ did not rise from the dead. It's all a lie. It's a fable. It's just a religion. It's just a crutch. If you repeated that for 24 hours, 7 days a week, for maybe 2 months, it would have a psychological effect on your mind. You would have to block that out. You say, what would you do if they did that to you? Well, they are doing that to you. You don't realize that. But those of you that are plugged into all this media stuff, and our kids, you put them into this curriculum where they're taught there is no God. All this stuff just evolved. It's just a big bang and there is no God. They're taught that stuff. And it's coming in very subtly. And you have to be careful. And you're working with people that believe there is no God. And they're living like there is no God. And that stuff gets on you. And if you're not careful, other people's doubts, even Christians that get away from the Bible and Christians that are falling in their faith, as they're falling down in their faith, they're going to pull you down. You have to be real careful. The problem with his faith was not just with the circumstances. It was with those he surrounded himself with, even the disciples. Now let's talk about the possibilities of his faith. Verses 22 and 23, he tells him about how bad it is. I mean, this devil is taking him, he's casting him into the water, casting him into the fire, trying to destroy him. He says, if thou canst do anything, verse 22, have compassion on us and help us. Verse 23, Jesus said unto him, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. Notice the contrast. This man, look at the words. If thou canst. That's what the man says in 22. Look in 23. Jesus says, if thou canst. He's taking it and flipping it right back on it. The man said, if thou canst do anything. Jesus said, all things are possible. The anything with Jesus becomes the all things. Notice, obviously, verse 23, the contingency, if thou canst believe, all things are possible. Believe what? I like the story in Acts 27 when the ship's going down and Paul's just, you know, like, hey, this is great. And Paul's like, you know, oh, well, ship's going down. And he says, I believe God. Because God had given him assurance that everything was going to be okay. God had given him peace of mind and God had given him assurance. Now, he had spent some time with the Lord, and that helps. You need to spend some time with the Lord and get that peace and get that assurance. And he says, I believe God. It shall be even as it was told me. Somebody tells you, look, this is all just a lie. Okay, you can tell me that all you want. I believe God. It shall be even as it was told me. The contingency. If thou canst believe. Now, don't say you can't believe because you've already told me you are a believer. The idea here then it goes from saying that I don't believe to the fact that you do believe. It goes from saying I don't have any faith to the fact that you do have faith. You just might have little faith. And so you need to increase your faith like the disciples said, Lord, increase our faith. So there's possibilities here. I like the fact that the Lord's always working on us. I like the fact that even when we struggle with things in our personal lives, the Lord says, you know, I see where I can help you with that. You know, there's never a lost case with the Lord. The Lord never says, you know what, everybody else gave up on Him. Everybody else gave, you know, they gave up on themselves. You ever give up on yourself? You beat yourself to, you know, beat yourself silly. Now you're like, oh well, forget it. The Lord's like, I'm not going to forget it. If thou canst believe, all things are possible. Why would God give you the book of Proverbs if you just have it in your DNA that you're a jerk? or you're a mean person, or you're a gossip, or you're lazy, or whatever you want to just blame on, that's just my character. Why does God give all those, or you can't keep your mouth shut? You ever read about the tongue? I have a whole, maybe going to do a whole series on that. There's about 18 or 19 or 20 different tongues in the Bible. Why would he give the book of Proverbs all these things about character and personality if God cannot change some things in your life? Thing is, you just don't want to believe it. The devil's done doubled up on your doubt, got you to thinking that God's just all through with you, and there's no way you're you can't teach an old dog new tricks, and I've just been doing it for so long. No, that's just a cop-out. Possibilities of faith. Verse number 29, notice we have a spiritual discipline, and this is where it comes into not just what God can do. Thank God He can. Thank God verse 23 is true. We understand that. There's nothing wrong with quoting verse number 23 as long as you quote it in the proper context. You're not, about to jump off the roof. All things are possible. I can fly. I can fly. You are nuts. So what's going to happen? You can believe all you want that you can jump off this roof and not be harmed. You are going to break a leg. And I might wait about 10 minutes before I call 911. Just because you were so stupid enough to do that. No, I wouldn't. I'd call 911 when you got on the roof. We need a sniper team in here immediately. Whatever team they call that, not the sniper team. We don't want to shoot you. Shoot them with a dart and drop them out. The possibilities. Verse 23 is in there. And there are a lot of verses like this in the Old Testament. Good verses for you to claim. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. I like the all things and those verses, as long as you understand the context of those. But notice the responsibility. Verse number 29, when he deals with the disciples in private, they ask him, verse 28, why could not we cast him out? And he said unto them, this kind can come forth by nothing but by prayer and fasting. Spiritual discipline. That's where people check out. Now maybe Peter, James, and John could have done it. They were with Christ and they come down. This is a day later and you have the other disciples that are down there with no power, no faith. Maybe Peter, James, and John, they come off the mountain. Maybe they would have had the power, but the other disciples didn't. Two things about this spiritual discipline I think we see with prayer and fasting. And by the way, when you see fasting in the New Testament, that's something that you see practiced with Paul the Apostle in his ministry. There's nothing in the Bible that says you can't fast nowadays. Matter of fact, it'd probably be good for some of us health-wise to do a little fasting. Maybe even on Sunday afternoons. Instead of the big meals, maybe a little smaller meals. Wow, I knew I wouldn't get an amen on that one. But here's the thing you want to understand with this thing here. Prayer and fasting. Spiritual discipline. Deny the flesh. Fasting. Prayer, feed the Spirit. Those two things. If you are not making a conscious effort to deny the lust of your flesh, things that gravitate towards sin in your life, in your mind, in your thoughts, if you're not making an effort to deny that, you are going to be filled with doubt and unbelief. I'm just telling you. You have to deny the flesh, and then you have to feed the Spirit. One reason we sing the songs over and over again, and we read the Bible over and over again, is because we remind ourselves. Not that we forget. I don't think I could ever forget John 3:16. That's probably one of the verses I memorized first in my Christian life, and many of you as well. A lot of times when we're in the nursing home, that's one verse that a lot of the residents will be able to quote. And it's a pretty long verse. But it's one of those verses that they've just nailed it down and they've repeated it and maybe learned it at a young age and it's set in stone. And there are certain things that even though you know them, you remind yourself because you're feeding the new man. You're bolstering that faith. You're building up that faith by reminding yourself there is a God. There is a heaven. There is a hell. Just like the song we heard. This stuff is real. This is not just some philosophical idea that some men came up with and wrote it down in the first century, and it's been passed on and blowed out of proportion and so forth. This is the truth. This book is a supernatural, amazing book. And the more you get in it, the more it stirs up the Spirit of God in you. The more you see with clear eyes, the more it verifies the fact that there's something on me that tells me this world's not my home, that tells me there's a better place. There's something in me beyond just the fact of the Bible. There's the faith that I have and the feeling of the Spirit of God on the inside of me that tells me this is true. And it encourages me. But in order to do that, it's like going east and west at the same time. You can't do it. You have to deny the flesh in order to feed the Spirit. And if you try to do both at the same time, it's not going to work. I think that's why a lot of the Christians in the contemporary churches maybe are failing, because they're embracing, and even in their own worship and everything, they've embraced so much of the world, and they've actually let down their guard and acted like it's okay. I mean, there are independent Baptist preachers walking around with Twitter accounts where all these people are following them and they're sitting here texting about their lives and all this. What kind of garbage is that? What do you think you are? Old Baptist Pope sitting on a throne somewhere? They're so immersed in themselves. I'm like, and now you're just saying it's okay for everybody just to let down their guard. It's okay to invite all the world in. It's okay to do all the things that the world's doing. No! If you are going to have God's truth nailed in your heart and have some belief instead of unbelief, you have got to have a spiritual discipline to be a Christian separated from things of this world. And that's where the church has fallen apart. I don't care what the statement of faith is on the Constitution and bylaws. You feed your unbelief by exposing yourself to devilish, anti-God media and entertainment and propaganda. And you can't do that. So, well, I'm strong enough. No, you're not. Now, I read of a group out on, they were out on a ship, and the waters got real rough, so what are they going to do? Obviously, they're going to throw on the anchor. You ever seen the anchors on some of those big ships? I mean, huge, unbelievable how these things could go hundreds of feet down in the ground and on the ocean floor and all that kind of stuff. But if you take that anchor and you get it out and you just put it down in maybe the cargo hold, it's not going to do any good. Well, I got the anchor out, and I'm, okay, take the anchor, put it in the car. What is that? That's not going to do anything. It's got to be connected to something more solid outside of it. The problem with your unbelief is a lot of times you're trying to anchor it within yourself or within the world instead of anchoring it in God and in His Word. Jesus Christ is the anchor of our soul. So your faith is only going to be built up when you anchor it outside of yourself. Now thank God the Father had enough faith to bring the boy to Jesus. Here's the question for you, and we'll be done. Do you have enough faith to bring your unbelief and your doubt and your discouragement, disillusionment? Do you have enough faith to come to Jesus? Come to Jesus with your devils. Come to Jesus with your doubts. Come to Jesus with your distress. I mean, this guy's pulled out of the frame. And then the last part with the disciples, come to Jesus with your discipline. It's a sad thing to know people can get up and they can be disciplined. Even in a lot of people are still working at home. They're able to be disciplined enough to work at home, clock in, do their hours, do other stuff, but they're not disciplined enough to read their Bibles every day. Or they're not disciplined enough to pray every day. Or they're not disciplined enough to spend time feeding the Spirit every day. Come to Jesus with your discipline. I think the lesson, when we take the whole chapter in consideration, and it's important that you realize that the Mount of Transfiguration experience takes place the day before this, the idea is never doubt in the valley what God showed you on the mountain. And here's Jesus Christ on the mountain. Everything is so crystal clear. They know this is the Son of God. They see Him in His glory. They got a glimpse of what it's going to be like when He comes back at the second advent. I mean, He's brighter than the sunshine. And they got to see that, Peter, James, and John did. And then they come down to all the confusion. They come down to the chaos. They come down to this scene of the scribes and the boy and all of this. You've got to realize that the Lord is our focus. And that's what they saw on top of the mountain. They saw no man save Jesus only. And He is the one who has got this thing. Don't be so focused on yourself. We're so selfish. I know you had to be focused on yourself this morning. You got in the mirror. Some of you couldn't get away from the mirror this morning. You know, it's just, we're not looking at you as much as you think we are. And we're all about us. We're all consumed with ourselves. It took me a long time to get this hairdo fixed just right this morning, I'm telling you. But it's not about your faith as much as it's about His truth. A group of students, they were working with a professor. You know how they have these college students go work with botanists and different things like that. And they had discovered this type of plant or a different species of a plant. But the area in which it was, where they needed to get the sample, was over this cliff. And it was a very difficult spot to reach. And in the area, there were some kids there. And they found a young boy, you know, kind of 12, 13, real small, skinny, wiry. They said, "Look, son, we're doing this experiment. We're doing this research and so forth. There's a plant that's hanging over. Would you let us? We have all this equipment here. We can strap you in. We can harness you in and lower you over this cliff. And we've got the ropes and everything, and we can let you down. Would you let us do this?" You know, they might have even offered him a little allowance money. He says, "On one condition, if you let my daddy hold the rope." The Lord's holding the rope through our faith. Don't hold your own rope. Let the Lord have it. He's got it all on. You say, "What'll happen? Do you believe? Are you a believer?" Okay, you're a believer. Let the Lord make up for the rest of your unbelief. And then, on your part, make sure you feed your faith and starve the flesh instead of feeding the flesh and feeding the doubts and starving out your faith. Amen? Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. I'm going to ask Sister Sherry to play us a brief invitational hymn. Maybe you just need to come to Jesus with your unbelief this morning. Maybe you're fine this morning. You're so much of a believer, you could just give us some of your faith. Why don't you pray for those you know that might be struggling? And always remember that you might